हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन नैनो पार्टिकल्स। इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय नैनो पार्टिकल्स, व्हाट आर द एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ नैनो पार्टिकल्स, इट्स मेथड्स ऑफ प्रिपरेशन, वेरियस इवेल्युएशन पैरामीटर्स एंड अप्लीकेशंस ऑफ नैनो पार्टिकल्स। फर्स्ट, what do you mean by nanoparticles? Nanoparticles are sub-nanosized colloidal structures composed of synthetic or semi-synthetic polymers, and their size ranges from 1 to 1000 nanometer. There are various types of nanometers. We will discuss prime types of nanoparticles in this part. That is, first type is polymeric nanoparticles. So these are the nanoparticles which are prepared by using various hydrophilic or hydrophobic polymers, and these polymeric nanoparticles are useful in targeted drug delivery system. They are used to increase the bioavailability, and they also can be used for sustained release or controlled release of drug. Then next type, it is fullerenes. So fullerenes means these are the molecules made up of carbon in different shapes, such as tubes or hollow spheres. So this is the structure of fullerenes, which is spherical in shape, as well as the fullerenes which are tube like structure, they are called as nanotubes. Next type is solid lipid nanoparticles. These are the nanoparticles which are solid in nature, and they are prepared from the solid lipids. They can load, or we can load, variety of drugs, but specially they are used for the loading of water insoluble drugs. Next type is super paramagnetic nanoparticles. These are the nanoparticles which are loaded, or which are having core of iron oxide. So as it has core of iron oxide, these nanoparticles are attracted towards a specific magnetic field. Means they are used mainly for drug targeting by application of external magnetic field. Next type, it is liposomes. As we know, liposomes we can prepare in nano size also. So nano size liposomes are also called as nanoparticles. Another type of nanoparticle is nanostructure lipid carriers. So these are prepared using blend of solid lipids as well as liquid lipids. Then next type is dendrimers. So this name dendrimer is derived from a Greek word, that is dendrons. It means a tree like structure. So dendrimers are polymeric molecules made up of multiple perfectly branched monomers. This is the structure of dendrimer. Means the monomers are perfectly branched. They are like a tree structure into which drug can be entrapped. So in this one dendrimer itself, many molecules of drugs can be entrapped, and their size is in nanometer range. So we can call them as a nanoparticles. There are several other types also, like nanofibers, gold nanorods, silver nanoparticles, nano erythrosomes, etc. In this presentation, among all the types just now we have discussed, we will focus on polymeric nanoparticles. So polymeric nanoparticles, basically they can divided or distinguished into nanospheres, means they are in which drug is entrapped in a polymer matrix. So they can also be called as a matrix system. And nano capsules, same principle, they can be a reservoir system, means drug molecules or drug particles, they are encapsulated in a polymer coat. Advantages of nanoparticles. Nanoparticles can be administered by various routes like parenteral, oral, nasal and ocular, as well as topical. So by attaching specific ligand or complexing agents, on their surface, nanoparticles can be used for directing the drug to a specific target cells. So main advantage, or most what we can say useful application of nanoparticle, is drug targeting. So by using drug nanoparticles, both active as well as passive drug targeting can be achieved by manipulating the particle size and surface characteristics of the nanoparticles. Nanoparticles also useful in improving the stability of the drug, to increase the therapeutic index and reduce toxic effects, as well as they can be used to enhance the bioavailability of the drug. Disadvantages. Definitely, being nanoparticles, the specific or instrument and technology is used, that's why they are expensive in nature. Their productivity is more difficult. They have less ability to adjust the dose. They require highly sophisticated technology for the preparation as well as for their evaluation. They require skilled person in the manufacturing process. Polymer used in preparation of nanoparticles. Various natural, semi-synthetic, synthetic polymers can be used for the preparation of nanoparticles. Then methods of preparation. There are number of methods of preparation. Among that, most commonly used methods we will discuss here. They are divided into three categories, that is amphiphilic macromolecule cross-linking, polymerization methods, and polymer precipitation methods. We'll see one by one. First method is cross-linking of amphiphatic macromolecules. So nanoparticles can be prepared from amphiphatic macromolecules like proteins and polysaccharides, which have affinity for aqueous and lipid solvents also. The technique of their preparation involves the aggregation of amphiphiles followed by further stabilization either by heat denaturation or by chemical cross-linking. The detail of this method we'll see by this flowchart. So first, what we are doing, proteins we are dissolving in an aqueous solution which containing the surfactant, and they are then emulsified with the oil. So this emulsification is carried out using high pressure homogenization or high frequency sonication. Means when we are using high pressure homogenization or sonication, the globule size will be in nanometer range. So we will get OW emulsion, and after getting this OW emulsion, we are denaturating the proteins or cross-linking. So this cross-linking can be done by dilution with preheated oil. This is called as hot cross-linking, or by addition of cross-linking agent. So this is called as chemical cross-linking. So this protein will be cross-linked and they convert into a nanoparticles. And these prepared nanoparticles, they are isolated by centrifugation process. Next method is polymerization method. So in that polymerization, first type is emulsion polymerization method. So emulsion polymerization, again it is of two types: micellar nucleation and polymerization, homogeneous nucleation and polymerization. So first, micellar nucleation and polymerization. This method includes swollen monomers, micelles, as a site of nucleation and polymerization. The monomer is emulsified in non-solvent phase with the help of surfactant molecules. We will see this diagrammatically. See here, these are the drug particles, these are the monomers, this is surfactant molecules, and these are the catalysts. These are the catalyst for the initiation of polymerization process. So when this process, we are mixing all this in a external phase of emulsion, the surfactant molecules, they will form micelles, and the monomers, they will try to concentrate or nucleate or at the nucleus of this micelle. So at this nucleus of micelle, they will, monomers will concentrate, and then the catalyst, which is the initiator of polymerization chain reaction, it will convert these monomers into polymers, and again these polymers chain length will increase, and they will stabilize into nanoparticles or nanospheres. Next emulsion method is homogeneous nucleation and polymerization. The monomer is sufficiently soluble in continuous outer phase. The formation of polymer chain is the next step, that is also called as oligomers, and at certain length oligomer precipitate and form primary particles which are stabilized by the surfactant, and addition of monomer input or fusion of primary particle forms nanoparticles. We'll see in diagrammatically, see these are the surfactant and molecules and these are the monomer molecules. So when monomer molecules comes in contact with the catalyst, so this square indicates the catalyst, they come in contact with the catalyst, they are activated monomers, and these activated monomers, they will form or they undergo the polymerization chain reaction, and they form a short chain that is called as oligomers. Now these oligomers in combination with the surfactants, they forms a primary particles, and these primary particle fuse with each other to form a larger particle that is called as nanospheres, and these are the stable molecules or stable particles. Next method is dispersion polymerization method. So up to now in emulsion polymerization, we have seen the monomer is emulsified in an immiscible phase using surfactant. But in case of dispersion polymerization, monomer is dissolved in aqueous medium, which act as a precipitant for polymer. Means what? In previous two methods, we have seen that monomer is dispersed, but in dispersion but in dispersion polymerization, monomer we are dissolving in a solvent, and in which solvent? Means the solvent which is a non-solvent for the polymer, means the solvent in which monomers are soluble but polymer is insoluble. So the monomer is introduced into dispersion medium, polymerization is initiated by adding a catalyst and proceed with nucleation phase followed by the growth phase. You can see here in dispersion polymerization, this M indicates the monomer which is dissolved in the solvent, and this is initiator. So in presence of initiator, the monomer starts the polymerization chain reaction. Now these monomers are dissolved in a solvent, and this same solvent is act as a non-solvent for the polymers, means polymer is insoluble. So as this monomer convert into polymer, this as these polymers are insoluble, they will precipitate out. So as they precipitate out, gradually they will grow in size and they convert into nanoparticles. So this is dispersion polymerization method. Next method is interfacial polymer condensation. The polymer and drug are dissolved in a volatile solvent. The solution is poured into a non-solvent for both polymer and core phase. The polymer phase is separated as a coadsorbate phase at OW interface. The mixture turns milky due to formation of nanocapsules. We'll see. See, core and drug, core material means drug plus other excipient, they are dissolved in an organic solvent. Polymer phase also is dissolved in an organic solvent. Then the OW emulsion is formed. So the polymer is present in this continuous phase. So when we are adding non-solvent for the polymer, means the solvent in which polymer is insoluble. So when we are adding non-solvent, the polymer will precipitate and it will concentrate at this interface of the core material and the continuous phase. So like this, this is core material and this is the deposition of polymer. So this method is somewhat similar to that of phase separation co-observation method of microencapsulation. So as the polymer is forming coating over the core, we are getting the nanocapsules, and nanocapsules obtained by this method ranges in size from 30 to 300 nanometer. Next method is polymer precipitation method. The polymer precipitation occurs as a consequence of solvent evaporation, which can be brought about by increasing solubility of organic solvent in external medium by adding alcohol. So this polymer precipitation methods further divided into three types: solvent evaporation method, solvent displacement method, and salting out method. We'll see one by one. First method is solvent evaporation method. So this method is same as we have discussed in microencapsulation process. So first, in organic solvent, drug and polymers, they are either dissolved or dispersed. Then in a dispersion medium, it may be aqueous or it may be any another liquid. In dispersion medium, we are dispersing the organic phase, so we are forming OW emulsion, and then by application of heat, this organic solvent from this dispersed phase, it is evaporated. So as solvent evaporates, the drug and polymer get solidified and they form a nanoparticles. So this method is called as solvent evaporation method. So again, for removal of solvent, there is another option that is called as solvent extraction method. So in previous year we have seen that is solvent evaporation, which can be brought about by increasing solubility of organic solvent in external medium by addition of alcohol. So this method is called as solvent extraction method. So what we can do here, suppose water is a continuous phase, and suppose any organic solvent is a dispersed phase. So when we are adding alcohol in water, what will happen? This alcohol will have more affinity towards the organic solvent, or vice versa, organic solvent will have affinity towards the alcohol present in the continuous phase. So what will happen? This organic solvent from these droplets will be extracted by the alcohol. So as organic solvent is going out, our polymer will precipitate and it will form nanoparticles. So this method is called as solvent extraction method. And when we are applying heat, that is called as solvent evaporation method. Next method is solvent displacement method. So in solvent displacement method, the polymer is precipitated from an organic solution, and the organic solvent diffuses in the aqueous medium in the presence of or absence of a surfactant. So in this method, use of semipolar water miscible solvent is very important. Semipolar water miscible solvent, for example acetone and ethanol, they are used to dissolve the polymer, drug and lipophilic surfactant. So we will see the mechanism or principle of this method. So in this method, what we are doing, first we are preparing organic phase. In organic phase, we are using again organic solvent like semipolar, maybe acetone or maybe ethanol. So in organic phase, we are dissolving drug and polymer. Then we are adding the aqueous phase. So as we are adding aqueous phase, we know that acetone or ethanol, they are miscible with the water. So what will happen? They will go or they get dissolved in water, and polymer and drug, they will salt out or they will precipitate out. So as they are precipitating, they form a matrix type system, that is nanosphere. See, in this diagrammatically we can see this orange color indicates the organic phase. So in organic phase the drug and polymer is present. This blue color is water phase, aqueous phase. So when water we are adding, this emulsion, from this emulsion the orange colored organic solvent will diffuse into the water and the polymer and drug will precipitate into small particles that are nanoparticles. By using this method we can also prepare nano capsules also, means reservoir system also we can prepare. So when we are using in organic phase polar solvent plus oil, then polymer and drug, means generally the drug is oil soluble in nature, so in oil we are dissolving drug and the polymer we are dissolving in a polar solvent. So we are forming such a mixture, and in this mixture we are adding the aqueous phase. So when water we are adding into this, see we can see in this diagram, see continuous phase is water. This blue color small droplets, they indicate the polar solvent containing polymer, and this small orange droplets, it is similar to that of multiple emulsion. This small orange droplets, they are drug dissolved in oil phase. So when we are adding water, what will happen? In this blue color polar solvent is there, this polar solvent will go into the aqueous phase because it is miscible with water. So as it is going into water, the polymer which is present in this polar phase will precipitate out and it will deposit around the interface of this oil globules, and as it is depositing upon this oil globule they form a nano capsules, means reservoir system. So by this system we can prepare nano spheres also, matrix system or nano capsules also. Next method of nanoparticle preparation is salting out of polymer. So this method involves incorporation of a saturated aqueous solution of polyvinyl alcohol into an acetone solution, which is also a water miscible vehicle of polymer, under magnetic stirring to form OW emulsion. So the question may arise that acetone is a water miscible vehicle, so how we can form emulsion with water? So in this method miscibility of both the phases is prevented by saturation of external aqueous phase with PVA, means as we know that acetone is miscible with water, but what we are doing, the aqueous phase we are saturating with the addition of polyvinyl alcohol, means being a saturated solution acetone cannot get dissolved or cannot get miscible with the water. So this principle we are using here in salting out method. So precipitation of polymer occurs when sufficient amount of water is added to the external phase to allow complete diffusion of acetone from internal phase to aqueous phase. This method is suitable for drugs and polymers that are soluble in polar solvents such as acetone and ethanol. Means requirement for this method is that we have to use the semi-polar solvent like acetone and ethanol. So when we are using acetone and ethanol, what happens when we are dissolving our drug as well as polymer in acetone or ethanol and we are mixing with aqueous phase which is saturated with the PVA, so we get the OW emulsion. Now being water is saturated one, the organic phase cannot get miscible with the water phase, but when we are adding excessive distilled water, so when we are adding excessive distilled water, now that this external phase, that is water, is no more a saturated one, so it have scope for the miscibility of the organic phase. So as we are adding excessive distilled water, the organic phase or organic solvent from the internal phase which will diffuse out and the polymer which is dissolved in this organic phase will salt out, and as it is salting out, it will form nanoparticles. So next it is evaluation or quality control testing of nanoparticles. So first and foremost quality control test is determination of particle size. So various methods, various sophisticated instruments are available for determination of particle size, like photon correlation spectroscopy also can be useful for very small nanoparticles, means nanoparticles having size less than 100 nanometers. Laser diffractometry for larger particles, it is useful. Electron microscopy, it require coating of conducting materials such as gold and limited to dry sample, means liquid samples we cannot analyze by this method. And most commonly used method is TEM, that is transmission electron microscopy. It is easier method and permits differentiation amongst nanocapsules, reservoir system and nanoparticles, that is matrix system. Other methods available that are atomic force microscope, laser force microscope and scanning electron microscope. These are generally used for the surface analysis of the nanoparticles. Next evaluation parameter is density. So helium or air using gas picnometers are used. Density gradient centrifugation method is also useful for determination of density. Molecular weight can be determined by the gel permeation chromatography using refractive index detectors. Then structure and crystallinity. So whether the nanoparticles prepared, they are amorphous or crystalline in nature, it can be determined by the X-ray diffraction technology. And the structural integrity of nanoparticles can be determined by the thermoanalytical techniques like differential scanning calorimetry, differential thermal analysis and thermogravimetry. Surface charge of nanoparticles can be measured by measuring the zeta potential. So it is very important for the nanoparticles, because surface charge of nanoparticles will determine its targeting effectiveness as well as its release pattern. Then next it is in vitro drug release. So in vitro drug release can be determined by the diffusion cell or maybe by the in vitro dissolution study, or recently modified ultrafiltration technique is also introduced. It can be also used, and generally media used for in vitro drug release is phosphate buffer. Then nanoparticle yield, it is similar to that of microcapsules, that the formula for determination is percentile is equal to actual weight of product divided by the total weight of excipient and drugs into 100. Drug entrapment efficiency or drug loading can be determined by the formula mass of drug in nanoparticles divided by the mass of drug used in the formulation, means label claim or theoretical value, and this is practical value into 100. Applications. Nanoparticles have variety of application in various industries. Nowadays it is most popular in cosmetology, but in pharmaceuticals also it has variety of applications, like application in cancer therapy for targeting the tumors. It is also useful in the intracellular targeting, so for example targeting of the reticuloendothelial system. It also useful as a vaccine adjuvant. It is useful in gene therapy for DNA delivery. It is also useful in the ocular delivery of drugs. These are the references for further detailed study. And thank you. Thank you for patient listening.